How you doing, everybody? My name is Reverend Anthony Evans, and I'm very happy to introduce to you Dr. Joseph Webster and Dr. James McCoy. Today's lecture, we're going to be talking about the importance of the role of a co-investigator and how to train more Black co-investigators in the clinical trial space. We have two experts on, so I'd like to say good morning first to Dr. Webster and then Dr. McCoy. Dr. Webster, give us a little bit back to your background, please.
Okay, good morning. I'm a pharmacist by training. I did medical school at University of Miami. I did my postdoc work in internal medicine and gastroenterology at UCLA. I've been practicing internal medicine and gastroenterology for the last 30 plus years. I currently only do gastroenterology. I have participated in some clinical trials way back about 15 or 20 years ago as an internal medicine specialist working with the All-Hat Hypertension Study. Have served on multiple committees at the National Medical Association level dealing with clinical trials and the project impact and others. So I've had some experience directly and indirectly with clinical trials.
Very, very good. Now we have Dr. James McCoy. He is a from the Morehouse School of Medicine and chair of NBCI Clinical Strategy Task Force. Give us some about your background, please.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Evans, and also thank you, Dr. Webster, for being able to participate in this particular very important presentation. I'm originally from Texas. I did my undergraduate at Texas Southern University.
I meant to call.
And I had my first 2 years of medical school at Harvard College of Medicine, D.C., and then transferred back to University of Texas Medical Branch, where I stayed there to do a combined cardiothoracic and general surgery residency. Then spent a couple of years out of the country. Two years of that. University of Nairobi School of Medicine. And then I've been in here in Atlanta for the last 40 plus years. Ten years of that was in cardiothoracic surgery as a private practitioner. Okay. And then for the last 31 years, I've been at university at the Morehouse School of Medicine in the Department of Surgery and Medical Education. My experience with clinical trials has been limited in terms of my own participation. I've had some opportunity to participate on the clinical with my colleagues, but my presentation will highlight the need for the clinical trials, and I will wait for that at that point.
Hey, thank you so much, Dr. McCoy. The name of this discussion, of course, is the role of co-investigators and how to train more Black co-investigators in clinical trials. And let me start off with the definition of a clinical trial. Before an investigative medicine, drug, vaccine, can be approved for use by the public, clinical research must be conducted. This is an important part of the creation of the discovery of new medicines and treatment because it allows the medical community to understand how safe and beneficial a potential medication, vaccine, or treatment may be. Let me ask you something, Dr. Webster. Is that an adequate definition, or should we add more to that?
That's a good high-level definition. Our audience is mostly lay people, are we not?
Yeah, it's both lay and clinical.
Yeah, and so now that covers the waterfront pretty well. That's a good definition.
Okay, very good. Now, in terms of Dr. McCoy, in terms of this definition, and I want to read to you one of the striking sentences in this definition that we have come up with. It is an important part of the creation and the discovery of new medicines and treatment because it allowed the medical community to understand how safe and beneficial a potential medication, vaccine, or treatment may be. Why don't you respond to that just in context?
Okay, well, say, so my response to that is that the essential reason for the clinical trials is because we need to find ways to reduce pain and suffering and death. And so it is the clinical trials that give us the new therapeutic measures, whether or not they'll be medicines, pharmaceuticals, or devices that will help us to reduce the suffering and death that we here in America experience. And clearly, the reason it's so essential for us to have this discussion today is because of the leading causes of death of cardiovascular and vascular diseases, lung cancer, and the other things that cause us to die, we in the underrepresented community have the highest percentage, the highest prevalence in our communities. And so it is critical that we be engaged in the clinical trials to reduce these morbidities and mortality associated with these disease processes.
Yeah, and you bring up a very interesting point. For African Americans, there are drugs out there that deals with a variety of disease states. And your presentation just a few minutes ago, a few seconds ago, Dr. McCoy said that it is critical that the African American community be involved in clinical trials because we needed to find out exactly how these new medications that has been discovered and the new treatment that has been discovered, how safe they are on Black physiology as opposed to Caucasian physiology, because I understand, being a lay person in this area, that we have a huge crisis, according to some researchers, and an adequate, and according to some other researchers, there's not a crisis. Let's clear this up. I want Dr. McCoy to respond and then Dr. Webb. Where we sit here in the African-American participation in clinical trial, give me a percentage number, give me your perception, give me some data about that.
Well, to my response to that is that basically African-Americans represent roughly 13% of the population. And there is not one clinical trial in which we reach that 13%. So when some, and occasionally we'll get close to that, but we never reach 13%. So that clearly means that the various therapeutic pathways that are being produced, we don't know how it will, whether or not it will be effective or whether or not it will be safe in our population. And so it is that, and so again, I make the point, that's why it's critical that we become a part of that, not only as participants, but also as investigators and co-investigators, so we would know, have firsthand information that we could then deliver to the population and our communities.
Okay, very good. Dr. Webster, can you respond to what Dr. McCoy just said?
Certainly. The numbers are 13% population. Some researchers say, well, some data sets say that we may approach 5%, 3% of the people in trials. But I agree with Dr. McCoy wholeheartedly. Very rarely do we average 13 or 15% in the clinical trials as patients. And then on the other hand, when it comes to investigators, that number is down in the single digits, 1%, 2%, probably at most.
Yes.
Just one thing, Reverend Evans, if I may interject, just a very two-sentence historical perspective on clinical trials. Everybody know about the so-called Tuskegee incident, which started really in the 1930s. But the real impetus for federal regulation of trials started after World War II with the Nuremberg trials, when the Germans were brought to trial for what they did to the Jews during the Hitler's regime. And so Germany at that time was the most advanced nation in the world in terms of science, in terms of biological science and the chemistry. And they were conducting all kinds of trials on their own subjects as well as the Jews. And that led to the Nuremberg trials. And then after that, the government, in particular in this country, started looking at and setting good clinical ethics protocols for conducting trials. And so the other part about the Tuskegee was the Public Health Service of the United States of America, which evolved into CDC. So the CDC was really responsible for the Tuskegee experiment on African-American experimentation that took place at Tuskegee. So it really wasn't a Tuskegee experiment. And so I think that's important to put in the whole thing about clinical trials in perspective. So now when they need African-Americans in clinical trials, we're excluded, whereas they abused us in 1930s in Tuskegee.
Well, that is definitely a famous case. And of course, the objective of this initiative is that NBC is ushering a new era concerning African-American participation in clinical trials. And we are turning the corner on the Tuskegee experiment. And I want you to emphasize this, with all lessons learned for the future. So you just highlighted exactly what we are trying to do by turning the corner on that whole situation and acknowledging that in terms of the past. Now you say 1% of clinical trial investigators. So let me give you a working definition of that so that we can further go into that conversation. A researcher, a physician, other health care providers who's responsible for supervising and leading the conduct of a clinical trial. A clinical investigator also protects the right, and what you talked to about on Tuskegee, they did not protect the right, they did not protect the safety and the welfare of the participants in clinical trials. And that is why we need more minority clinical trial investigators. Now there were, to be honest, there were African-Americans who was participating with the US public service at that time and knew far aware what they were doing to those subject doing the Tuskegee experiment, correct?
Well, that is correct. And we have been, they were hoodwinked initially. They did not know initially what they were doing in that part, but as the second phase, and once penicillin became available, and when the opportunity to either treat those patients and or call off the study, then at that point, they were co-participants.
Right.
Yes. So, Reverend Evans?
Go ahead.
If I make a comment here, the issue of the Tuskegee experimentation, actually, I wouldn't call it experimentation because it was actually an atrocity. Is the thing that we have now identified as an issue. I think clearly at this point in our history, we need to help our folks understand that we as individuals who are members of the church fully understand that Jesus has come into the world that we may have life and may have it more abundantly. So we shouldn't be holding ourselves hostage to the Tuskegee experiment anymore. We need to learn for ourselves, our own magnificent being, our own magnificent biology and physiology, and then to be able to improve upon it as God has told us to do. And so I would like to suggest, and this is a part of this particular presentation, that we make a statement at this point that we're going to learn. The healthcare providers are going to help our everyday lay people in the churches learn about the magnificence of our human body and how to protect it, how to do the trials, and how to live effectively and abundantly. So our discussion today is not about the history, but us going forward. You know, Jesus came into the world that we may have life more abundant. And so that's the message that should come from here. So we have clinical trials so that we know how to prevent the various kinds of disease processes and illnesses and abate the suffering that we have. In this country, it is shameful that we Black Americans have in our communities have dialysis centers on every other block. That's disgraceful, because we know what to do about the kidney disease. We know how to control the hypertension. And so I'd like for us to look at how to get our young people into the pipelines to study health, medicine, and learn about the things that they're eating that are not good for their bodies, and that we can understand those kinds of things. But until we become, we have to take ownership of our own lives in connection as God has given it to us, and to improve upon it. So we no longer have to have anyone telling us what to eat, what not to eat. We need, and what medicine we should take and what not medicine we should not take. We have to take ownership of that, because God is holding us responsible for that. And as members of the church, we are guilty for not giving full attention to the health of our members.
And I absolutely agree with you. Let me read this right here. On July 12, 1974, the National Research Act was signed into law, therefore creating the National Commission on the Protection of Human Subjects on the Biomedicine and Biobehavioral Research. One of the changes of the commission was to identify basic ethical principles that should be undergirded the conduct of biomedicine and behavioral research involving human subjects, and to develop guidelines which should be followed to assure that such research is conducted according to those principles. And so, and Dr. Webster pointed to this, and you did as well, is that now there are safeguards in place to prevent no more Tuskegee in our communities. And we are working with the industry to assure that in terms of moving forward. So in terms of changing the state of principal investigators and co-investigators, let me read you this. In clinical research, there must be an effort toward inclusion of minority investigators, beginning with the invitation to participate in clinical research that will benefit their patient and population. More efforts are generated from the National Institute of Health compared to other sponsors, which makes minority investigators feel out of place. So what they're saying is basically the government, since that time, since the early 70s up until that time, have made major strides toward including African-American co-investigator clinicians. And the industry has lagged behind, but the industry has taken on a new spirit, I understand, because I have talked to many of them, Janssen being one of them, in terms of including more African-Americans investigators into their studies. Let's get into the benefits of including African-American co-investigators into one study. Dr. Weston, won't you take that?
I will, and I'd like to close on the CDC part. The reason I brought that in, number one, people don't know that it was CDC. But number two, there's an accountability level at the federal level that still has not made great strides. So I agree that they are making some strides at the federal level. But if we are to ever reach equity and parity, the federal government has to assume its side of, with the FDA and others, of making those strides even stronger, and the language has to be stronger. But certainly, as far as including both minority patients and minority investigators, with investigators, it would be more likely to get minorities to participate in the trials. Black people like to go to doctors that look like them. And so for non-African-American physicians to try to recruit African-Americans and our Hispanics into the trial is going to be a little bit more difficult than if it was if we had people that look like the participants in the trial. So that's one benefit, just to increase the likelihood of getting subjects. Number two, the cultural aspect of it would be more unanimous, so to speak, that if we had the cohort that the doctor and the patient looked alike, doctors could understand the cultural variances a lot better than non-African-American physicians or investigators in getting them to participate in the trials. A lot of misunderstanding about what people of different cultures like, what they do not like, based upon generalizations in our society, could be overcome if you had the right match between the patient and the investigator, both being of similar or the same culture. And so all of those are kind of benefits, because a lot of drawback and pushback is because the patient does not feel comfortable being in a particular clinical trial because they don't trust the investigator.
So let me read you a couple of this right here. We must change the way scientific organizations engage African-American researchers, move beyond just checking the box, not truly intriguing or incorporating Black and minority scientists into their structure in a sustainable way. The second point I like to make here is that Black co-investigators should be fully orientated to the project, the trial designed, the objectives of the institution. The research should be appropriately allocated to such. So that speaks volume right there, is that if institutions, and especially not just the government, but pharma and other research institutions like Johns Hopkins, will take a serious commitment to include African-Americans, particularly African-Americans co-investigators into their, it says here, the design of the clinical trial. So that really speaks to at the very beginning, and not bringing a co-investigator into the trial in the third level of the trial when they know that the drug has worked and they are only dealing with the issue of safety. But this speaks to the fact that African-American investigators should be at the beginning of that. Won't you take that, Dr. McCoy, and expand on that?
Thank you again, Reverend Evans. I guess at the end of this presentation, you'll be an MD or PhD one.
Right. Right.
That issue of the major institutions not representing underrepresented minority, I think there's a two-headed issue. One is if you are in control of an institution and you are profitable, you'll get in publication, you have no real interest in changing your ways. And on the other hand, if we are in the Black community kind of plodding along, making a little bit of progress, but not a lot of progress, we have to be more deliberate and intentional about what we need to do for our people, both as professionals and as everyday citizens. And so it is important then that these kinds of presentations that we're having now take place, and it takes place in a widespread way across the nation. And it should take place in our churches, in our county, and our cities as well, have these kinds of discussions, so that, and especially where we have large underrepresented communities where the illnesses are occurring. And so I think that it is very important that these kinds of presentations take place, and that we make every effort to have our leaders in the Black institution take a greater role in actually bringing the younger individuals into roles of clinical investigators and even basic science researchers as well. But also in our medical school, we actually train our medical students, give them some idea while they're in medical school about clinical trials and clinical research. So they can be attuned to that as they go forward in their training.
Yeah, I think that that's a strong idea, but let me sort of answer part of your concern right now. I'm sure you're aware, and many of our folks out there are aware, certainly in our churches, is that the National Black Church Initiative has the CTEAPP program, and that's Clinical Trial Education Awareness and Participation Program. We launched this program some 10 years ago and certainly have been able to really dig in. I think our statistical status is that we well over 200,000 to 300,000 people that we have educated around the principles of and the benefits of clinical trial. And beyond these lectures that we are doing now, we have a 15 city tour on the clinical education awareness and participation program. So we do plan to take this on the road to cities like Baltimore, Chicago, Detroit, LA. So we are gearing up that. Of course, the only thing that's stopping us right now is COVID. But the whole question comes down to the fact that we certainly have been engaging our 27.7 million members, and we will continue to engage them through this new initiative that we have with Janssen and also our CTEAPP program. Let me read this, Dr. Webster, and you respond to this. They can recruit minority participants to match minority compositions and population being investigated more easily. And the premise is if they had African-American co-investigators. And I wanted to ask you, have your experience in working either with pharma, with a teaching university down in Tallahassee, who has recruited you for any clinical trial program as a legitimate, and when I say legitimate co-investigator, that means that not only have you been participating in the design of the program and the objectives of the program, but that you were just not added as a checklist that they had a Black co-investigator there. And what would be your suggestions in trying to improve those relationships going forward?
Well, there are several layers to your question, Reverend Evans, and I will try to dissect them out. As far as at the university level, the average clinician, private practitioner, as I was and still am, there are very few trials that the doctor would have to his wherewithal to be able to participate in it if it comes to providing a nurse, nurse coordinator, statistician, those kind of things for him to actively engage in the clinical trials, either at the university or a big pharma. And so the one trial that I did participate in was a hypertension trial. It was a national study called the All Hat Trial. It was centered out of UT Austin in Texas. And the National Heart, Blood, Lung Institute, CDC, NIH, and all of those, a multi-state study of thousands of patients. But it was grossly underfunded. And most of the studies that are run by the government are underfunded to the point that unless the doctor has a clinical research organization that's almost a standalone, he'll go broke trying to participate in the trial. So there has to be, on the part of recruiting physicians to participate in clinical trials, a greater effort, a deliberate effort to make sure that the doctor will not lose money by participating in the trials. And that has not taken place across the board. Now, there are several national initiatives that have been, the Project Impact is one of them. There are several others like that, that have been a kind of hybrid between the government and private industry. And that success is not very good for that program because what I just stated, the reimbursement and the timeline is very difficult for the doctors to meet. So what I've not seen, Reverend Evans, is a genuine support on the part of pharma in really trying to make it sustainable for a minority physician to participate in the trials.
Okay, let me also piggyback on that. You have not seen that. Are you not impressed, Dr. Webster, what NBCI is trying to do by bringing pharma and with Black co-investigators together so that they can increase more Black investigators in that respect?
Well, certainly I'm impressed with the effort. My question is, and my hope is that there's going to be dollars to match the need. And I and you and I both know, and pharma knows, that there have been numerous efforts, but the dollars didn't match the needs. And so unless and until such time as the dollars match the needs, Project Impact went around this country. NBCI was involved in some of those training sessions with Jim Powell. I've been involved in hundreds of them, probably with Jim Powell, in multiple cities around this country. And we have doctors out there trained, good clinical practice skills. We certify them, train, but they still have not found the studies and that will support them and get them into trials. So it has to be a two-way street. Big Pharma got to come to the table with some big bucks and big commitment, along with NBCI, finding the people and finding the doctors, and then we get the right mix, and then we can move forward with some good progress.
Yeah, I want to ask you a follow-up question from that. So I want you to put a pin in that right here. Let me read this, Dr. McCoy, and then I want to ask you a follow-up question. They can help choose investigation sites as that is accessible, safe, and culturally competent for all research participants. Faith-based communities are good venues for the Black population, which you spoke of earlier. And is it not possible that they will be making the institution venue more culturally welcoming? So let me just state from the outset that the National Black Church Initiative, with 150,000 churches, welcome any pharmaceutical company who want to come to the table and use our church as a research venue. We are open, as well as demonstrated recently during this present crisis. So, but my particular question to you, Dr. McCoy, is that you have Mercy University there, which is a teaching hospital, which is a teaching university, and I think they have a hospital as well. Then you got Morehouse. Is there an agreement between Mercer and Morehouse in terms of working on not only co-investigators, but principal investigators moving forward? Because Mercer will have no excuse to say that they can't find these qualified individuals, because they have right next door one of our premier medical school, Morehouse School of Medicine. Go ahead, Dr. McCoy.
Yes, let me just correct you. So it's not Mercy, it's Emory.
Emory University, I apologize. Emory.
Yeah. And so clearly, Emory, and you've seen several Emory professors in this COVID situation talking about the vaccine and the development of the vaccine. And so they have well-established researchers that are continually producing and engaged in both basic science as well as clinical research. We at Morehouse School of Medicine, we have a number of ongoing program projects, but obviously we don't have the same kind of funding or the support. And so clearly it makes a difference in that regard. There's still some working relationship between Morehouse and Emory. We share the same large teaching hospital, Grady Memorial Hospital, that's funded principally by two counties. But we share those spaces. And for the most part, the working relationship is friendly, supportive one. But as you well know, when it comes down to large sums of money, it is the ethical behavior sometimes become a little softer in terms of what one does under those circumstances. And so to answer your question specifically, we have had some working relationships on the clinical level, delivering clinical care with Emory. But in terms of the research, we have not actually been able to overcome that particular barrier in terms of any large funded projects that we have done together.
Reverend Evans.
Go ahead.
I'm going to, if we've got one more question that I can take, I got my rooms are backing up and I really got to go see my patient. My nurse.
Okay, very good. Yeah, I wanted to, I'll come back to Dr. McCoy, but I wanted to follow up with you about the possibility of work. First of all, let's identify who James Powell is. He's a pioneer in the area who have spent over 30 years encouraging African Americans to participate in clinical trial and was very instrumental in the National Medical Association Project Impact that still goes on to this day. And we salute him for the work that he has done, and certainly NBCI could not have done what they're doing without the James Powells of the world. I wanted to ask you, what is the possibility of the national, you know, because you're a member of the National Medical Association, I'm not asking you to speak for them, but certainly about the possibility of joining forces once again in a new defined relationship with bio and pharma and other pharmaceutical companies in this sort of George Floyd era that we're in, to really make a commitment over the next 10 years of increasing not only co-investigators, but principal investigator. What do you think of that ideal moving forward? And do you believe that the atmosphere will support it?
I think the atmosphere will support it. I think that what the NMA would want to see is a little bit more bite in the recommendations coming down from pharma, a little bit more commitment in terms of the actually quite frankly the dollars and sustainability of the dollars. Dr. Powell was initially on loan to the NMA from the private sector, from pharma. And so more of those kind of pharma has the resources to loan other Jim Powells to the effort. And so with a well-crafted program that will bring all the players together with the 150,000 churches and other the strength of the NBCI and others, I think it's time for moving forward in a comprehensive, collaborative way. And so I think that if the stakes are promising, there would be no reason why NMA would not be a willing partner as we partner going forward. Mm-hmm. But
go ahead.
Add whatever
you need to add, and then you can leave.
Right. But I want to, number one, to the audience, thank you, Reverend Evans, for your vision again and your foresight and bringing this together. Clinical trials and the lack of our participation even add to the health disparity gap, because we're not at the table when the medicines are produced. And so quite frankly, some of the poor response for the medicine is probably because we were not at the table. That's added on top of the difficulty in access to medications, access to doctors, access to everything else, all the other barriers. And then when you finally get a chance to see a doctor, the medicine that you get wouldn't try it on you. And so I think it's just an insult to injury that we certainly need to begin to talk about closing the disparity gap. We got to add more people upstream so that the medicine that finally get down to our communities will indeed work on us. And so I think that you're definitely on target for putting this together. I can commend you, Brother Dr. McCoy, always good sharing the platform with you. Couldn't see your smiling face this morning, but I know it's smiling. So thank you for all that you do as your leadership position of the Clinical Trial Task Force for NBCI. And again, the best weekend to both of you, but I got to go. My nurse is looking at me with crossed eyes, so I got to go. And God bless you, and God bless the effort.
And God bless you, Dr. Webster, and tell your nurse that you were doing God's work.
Okay. Well, she understands that, but I'm not sure the patients do. Okay. Okay, well, thank you.
Well, you heard it live here on Zoom that we're working with a real doctor that's seeing real patients, and certainly we salute Dr. Joseph L. Webster, Sr., who is an outstanding physician in Tallahassee, Florida. Now that I have my Dr. McCoy, I wanted to piggyback on what we talked about in terms of the possibility of building that type of relationship on a regional level. And you're down in Atlanta. And I think that we can duplicate that type of relationship between the Black Church, the teaching hospital, Emory, the medical school, Morehouse. What do you think that the Black Church need to do to facilitate a relationship like that because of the platform that we have built?
Again, I would echo Dr. Webster's kind words toward you in terms of putting this together. I think it is much needed. To answer your question, in our community, we still need to overcome some of our own inherent biases. And what I mean by that is our kind of emotional upbringing sometimes does not allow us to see how valuable other Black individuals are. And so it is important that I would say before we can actually begin to come together, maybe the Black Church Initiative could just look at how we could come together and see how wonderful it would be for us to work together. And I think that your example about some things that have been done under your initiative would be demonstrate the value of working together. I think that that's a key issue, is that we often are more competitive than we are working as team players together in our communities. And so I think that we have some work to do in order to build those bridges and overcome some issues.
Yeah, so that's good. So it leads me into this right here. Let me give you a little bit more about our clinical trial education awareness and participation program. And one of the things that we're doing this year that we haven't done years before is that we are really engaging the local physicians in those areas. So we're going to Baltimore in a couple of months, and we're going to hold an in-phase session of CTEAPP. And of course, we're going to social distance and be with our masks. But one of the things in Baltimore, we have a church called Israel Baptist Church. The pastor is Holly Wilson there. He agrees to host this, our first CTEAPP this year because of COVID. And we have Dr. Tucker, who is a member of that. She's a medical doctor who's a member of that particular congregation, who's going to engage her members on several levels. The first level is what you spoke about so eloquently, about the making sure that they understand the caring and the love that African-American physicians have for their patients, and especially for their congregation if they're part of it. I know that you, Dr. McCoy, is a part of a congregation right in Atlanta, and you also sit next to a larger congregation, United Methodist, larger congregation there. But Dr. Tucker, who have been a part of that congregation for some 30 years, is working with us. We're going to put together probably about 60 people. They got a mega church. So 60 people in a mega church is really more than 6 to 8 to 10 feet apart with masks. And we're going to conduct this CTEAPP, our clinical trial education and awareness program there. So let me read you this right here and let you respond to it. They will keep cultural mistakes from beginning. They will keep cultural mistakes from becoming a part of the research design, going back to the research design approach. An example would be not scheduling appointment exclusively on Saturdays if they are Jewish, or if African Americans are Muslim, not to do it on Friday, so that you don't have these cultural conflicts in moving forward. Of course, NBCI is a faith-based clinical trial initiative, so we are very sensitive to the religious calendar in terms of not making those mistakes. But those who don't know it need to reach out to us and work with and let us work with them so that they do not come in our community and make those basic mistakes. So reminding our people about that they have not learned what we said about this turning the corner on Tuskegee, that they have not learned the lessons of Tuskegee and other incidents that we have had.
Yes, I mean, you make a very good point in terms of failing to recognize various sacred days that the various religious groups have. And I think that's kind of a short-sighted thing that happens. But when you incorporate, one does not think of those things. So I think that your initiative in terms of helping the corporates to understand that is a very important one. But I think that it's important that as we go forward, that we inculcate in our younger generations that same spirit, that we were not all brought up either Baptists, Methodists, Lutherans, Episcopalians, but also, I mean, obviously there's a really a large Islamic group, both who have come here to the States as well as those who have become so, who live here from generation to generation. And so it is important that we learn to respect those various religious practices and divisions and honor those and not be disrespectful. And so I think that's again a valuable thing that could come out of this particular presentation that we see in each other.
Well, absolutely. What we attempt to do here at NBCI is to bind the spiritual aspect with the scientific benefits and sort of bring them together. And this is why we have created CTEAPP. One of the things that you said and Dr. Webster said that is clearly needed in the industry is a cultural checklist. And I know that you will work with me and at Morehouse and other institution of helping to create this cultural checklist for Farmer and for other investigators so that when we do partner, that they do not make these simple cultural mistakes. But let's wrap this up by talking about just one other question. Go ahead.
Let me just make one other little point here that since it's right in my backyard, is that when I first came to Atlanta a little over 40 years ago, one of the hospitals that I was most impressed with was the hospital that had been created by the Catholic group here in Atlanta, in Southwest Atlanta. That was a thriving hospital, and it continued to thrive until there was a kind of a shift of the individuals from the community who had insurance and wealth went across town to the other hospitals. And now that facility is a clinical trial center that's owned and operated by one of our Jewish brethren. And I wanted to bring that out because here we had a facility in our community, and now it is conducting clinical trials. And the reason it's in our community is so that it can recruit the underrepresented minority to the clinical trial study. That's my point.
Well, but that's, and what's the name of that institution?
Right now?
Yeah.
It's called the Atlanta Clinical Trials Center.
Yeah, that's good. And certainly those are the type of institution that NBCI should be engaging with in the future. So yes. What can the health community and researchers do to engage the communities of colors in clinical trial? Let me read this and let you respond to it. Hearing their concerns, and attempt to address them while educating them about the importance and benefits of clinical trials and the potential of being high quality care to bringing high quality care to their community and engaging with the community education program such as CTEAPP, our Clinical Trial Education Awareness and Participation Program. So do you believe that is an accurate statement that can go a long way of helping to engage community of color into clinical trials?
Yes, I certainly do. And I'll just go back to one of my original statements. I think that as members, you know, as 150,000 churches in these United States, the more we can help those churches to understand that we as individual, one by one, are created in the image of God, and that God has given us the authority to improve upon our lives in every way. And so one of the essential ways, critical ways to do so, is that we take a more deliberate and intentional control of our physical, just as we are in tune with our spiritual, that we combine that with our biological being and make every effort to put those two in tune with each other. And if we do that, we will have to participate in the clinical trials, both as investigators, as participants. I'll end there.
We thank everybody who stayed with us throughout this critical discussion about the role of core investigators and how to train more Black investigators in clinical trials. I also like to commend our lecturers of today, the Dr. Joseph L. Webster, Sr., medical doctor out of Tallahassee, Florida. And of course, Dr. James McCoy of the Morehouse School of Medicine and chair of NBCI Clinical Task Force. So we thank you and we look forward to the 19th, which we will have another discussion concerning a different aspect of clinical trial come. So we salute you. Thank you very much. We're looking forward to taking the next steps together.